So good morning. Thank you for attending. I'm Paul Bamberger. I'm going to be talking about securing write facts, and I'm technical lead for fact solutions within Process Flows. So Process Flows, as you probably know, have been on the around for a long time, over 30 years now. We do a whole range of things. In addition to fax technology, business process outsourcing, unified communications, document management, and many other services. So why are we talking about securing faxes? Why do we use them? Why do they need to be secured? Well, it's still widely used. Despite many predictions of its death, fax is still a very, very widely used technology, perhaps not at the level it was 20 years ago, but still the financial industry, legal industry, public sector, and particularly health and regional government, and even supply chain and distribution and manufacturing, all those sectors are still using a substantial amount of fax. For many, it's the security of standing next to a device to either send or receive a fax. But for others, it may just be that they don't consider email secure. Fax, it's straightforward to use. It's an 11-digit number for a domestic fax, and it's known to be point-to-point. And finally, one of the other things that drives it is that it is a legal document. I think you'll find that pretty much every UK legal firm will have at least one incoming fax number so that they can be served court papers. There is one other thing as well. Though there are other solutions for signing documents, still a wet signature is important for a lot of documents for a lot of companies. And digitally signed PDFs, that type of thing, should have replaced it, but in reality, they haven't done. So let's talk a little bit about what are the risks that we as an organizations need to think about. And this, we're talking about fax servers and fax here, but actually they apply more widely. So when we're thinking about the risks from a security point of view, there's several things. It can be people wanting to steal data. Most commonly is sweeping up financial details, bank account numbers, credit card numbers, perhaps other personal information. It might be that people want to modify data, perhaps a payment instruction where the recipient bank account, that people will try and modify that. It might be that it's more a case of wanting to get into a network and plant malware or some other software to extort information or money from an organization. Or it might just be disruption, denial of service, well known for issues around websites and that type of thing. And then the question is, well, who's doing that? A lot of the people involved with this are external, but there is also, and has for a long time, been a risk from internal attack. And we need to definitely think about securing the networks internally as well as externally now. So Mark Barron-Chair, who is the CEO of OpenText at the OpenText World Conference this summer, he said this: you have to assume that bad actors are already inside your network. And I think most organizations, particularly government and financial organizations that we deal with, are all now looking at how they completely secure internally within their network, not just making sure that the gates are closed and the firewalls are up. So, what are the motivations? Well, they could be financial gain. It could be people aren't happy with what's going on in an organization and want to interrupt or interfere with that. And it could also just be that they're not happy with the organization they work for or an organization that they are interacting with. So those are all risks. As you can see on that chart there, the most common one is financial. This data, by the way, comes from the Verizon annual report that they do on data breaches and security. I highly recommend it. You can download it from their website, and it's a very good read. So who's being targeted? When they did surveys, what they found was that of these various types of organizations, so healthcare, 24% of organizations said they'd been attacked. Amazingly, 58% of businesses surveyed said that they had had some sort of breach. Now, the other thing that we need to think about a little bit as well is regulation. So though some organizations, you may not be concerned about a large number of attacks, but you might be concerned about meeting a compliance requirement. And particularly MiFID II and PCDISS, they have requirements to do with securing data within and outside of your networks. And of course, everybody this year has been talking about GDPR, which has to be considered as well. Internationally, there are other regulations. If you deal with American companies, you might be affected by SOX or HIPAA, and pretty much every country now has a Data Protection Act of some sort, mostly just saying don't distribute data and keep it secure. Let's talk about one other thing as well. So this summer, there was a news report about fax machines being hacked and not being secure. Now, what had happened was that Checkpoint, who are a security investigation team, they'd managed to hack a Hewlett-Packard multifunction device. Now, actually, when you looked at it, from the reports, you'd think that fax was no longer secure. But it wasn't the T30 protocol that had been hacked. What had actually been hacked was the operating system on the device. They just managed to do that via the T30 route. So what had happened was that they'd actually exploited a fault with the operating system. OpenText, who make WriteFax and many other fax products, have been quite specific that when they investigated the exploit, this was an operating system exploit, not a protocol exploit. So if you have WriteFax in your system, you have, to an extent, a certain number of things you can do out of the box. WriteFax has been considered a secure solution for a long time, and there's a lot of things that you can do with a standard implementation without needing extra functions or licenses or features. So WriteFax itself was built on a Windows server, and that can be secured in many, many ways. Most organizations now will deploy a Windows server in a hardened form. WriteFax uses a SQL database. Again, that can be made highly secure, and there's plenty of technologies and processes for doing that. WriteFax uses T30 and T38. Those are fax-only protocols. There's no data paths in those. It's all about fax data only, and in packets that come through that are not fax are dropped within that standard. And WriteFax doesn't support modems. There are devices and products out there that use fax modems, which are basically combined fax and data modem device. WriteFax doesn't do that. It's only fax devices that are used, whether it be virtual or physical. One of the other important things as well is it's a true client-server architecture. That means that the factors that a user might be looking at in their client, they're not synced to the local machine. Whenever a user views a fax in FaxUtil, they're viewing it from the central server. And with WriteFax, it's also possible to have it as a transient platform, especially if you're concerned about the fact that it is connecting to the outside world. So an incoming fax can route to WriteFax, and it can be deleted immediately after having been routed perhaps onto a workflow or document management system or into email. And WriteFax can delete those faxes immediately, or it can be done on a retention policy. And the same can be done for outbound fax. WriteFax maintains a detailed audit trail. Everything that users do when they view faxes, when they print them, modify them, all that is recorded. Administration activities are also audited, and there is a specific report for everything administrators do. And finally, there is a full fax history. This means that every fax has its own record about the life of it through the WriteFax server. When it arrived, what the source device was, how long it took, how many pages, who viewed it, who annotated it, who printed it, who deleted it, all of that is retained. So a full history of what's there. Okay, so we're going to dig a little bit deeper. And to do that, we need a quick reminder of the WriteFax architecture. So let's talk about this fairly quickly. So WriteFax is built up of four things in principle. We've got a database. The database contains all the configuration and records about faxes and users. It doesn't contain the faxes itself. We have shared storage. This is where the faxes are, and fax images are stored at rest in the shared storage. We also keep other files there, like library documents and forms. Then we have queues. So message queues are the list of tasks that the application uses when it's operating. So that might be a list of document conversions for cover sheets or attachments. And it will also contain lists of faxes ready to be sent and inbound faxes ready to be routed. Those are all handled through Microsoft Message Queuing. And finally, the last component is the application. The application could be multiple servers. It's normally only one, but in shared services, it's multiple servers that connect to those other three resources. It handles connections to the outside world and client connections and application integration. All those are handled by the application. Now, typically, this is the architecture where three of the components, application, queues, and shared storage, all sit on a single server and the database is held externally. There are other ways. If you have shared services, it looks quite different, but that is probably the most common architecture. Okay, so let's start and look at securing the images at rest. That's the shared storage. So introduced in version 10.6 of WriteFax was the encryption module. This allows images at rest in those folders, which are the shared storage, to be encrypted. Now, those files are stored as CCITT image files. That's not, it's not an encrypted format. It's not that easy to open, but they are, they're plain. The content can be viewed. So the encryption module will encrypt those at rest. To decrypt them, the files actually need to be pulled into the application server. And if they're going to be viewed in the fact util or the web client, well, those are secure connections. And so the keys are never handled outside of the server. That means everything that's done is fully, fully encrypted, and there's no point where it's in any form that can be looked at. This is particularly important for PCI DSS compliance, where anything where it's personal information or credit card numbers or account numbers has to be encrypted, and this will help meet that compliance. So that's images at rest. What about images in flight? So this is a typical architecture, nice simple diagram. We've got a WriteFax server connected via SIP to a telephone system or maybe an SBC or a gateway of some sort out to the public network. So we're talking about inside the firewall here. This is in the network. And this connection of SIP is normally unencrypted. What we can now do is encrypt that link. It's SIP over TLS. There are other protocols available, but this is the one that we're supporting. And it will work with the majority of industry standard SIP gateways and devices. It's licensed per channel. So if you've got multiple channels on multiple servers, they still all need to be encrypted, and it's a per unit license. I think it's worth saying as well that outside of that network, it will be whatever encryptional security is available in the public network, and it still remains point to point, but with a SIP encryption will encrypt anything internally. So what about outside of the network? One of the products that's actually exists as a component within WriteFax is WriteFax Secure Docs. In this scenario, a user wanting to send a fax to an external recipient would put, rather than a fax number, an email address. They'll be sent a link, and the link will link back into your own IS server with whatever encryption and security you decide to wrap around that. So it's secure email, but it's off the back of the source being whatever applications or user experience you have for sending faxes. And the WriteFax clients actually give a record of what's happening. Now, it's not a new module. It was introduced in 2002 in WriteFax version 8. And anybody with an enterprise suite or above, you've already got this module. It's actually part of the solution. It's just a case of setting it up and configuring it. It will send an encrypted PDF or a link. So you can actually do both options there. So it's worth mentioning that one of the things that still drives fax is the fact that people start with a piece of paper. And at a very practical level, where you find physical fax machines still in your organization, it will be argue that they need to exist because a user has a piece of paper they have to send by fax. And we know that a physical fax machine, it exposes the organization to risks that are not part of, they're quite hard to control within the network. They're hard for the IT department to control and the governance people to control, because they're a device that doesn't really have any checks and balances on it. So using multifunction printers, whether that be something that provides a managed contract or just devices that you own, to send faxes instead is very important. With those devices, especially if users authenticate, they'll be identified to the right fax server. The right fax server will send the fax on their behalf, and they'll get electronic notification. And as an organization, there's an audit trail. This is one of those layers of security which is inherent in RightFax. Anything sent through RightFax is recorded. So for multifunction devices, any device that can send an email can be fax enabled, but there are better feature-rich integrations for most of the standard multifunction devices on the market. So the big brands have all got dedicated connectors. And we can also cope with a mixture. So RightFax can actually connect to more than one brand at the same time. So one thing we talked about earlier was that the images are stored in the image store. What we see as a problem with some enterprises is when they're making RightFax resilient and they're putting it in multiple locations, a database is fairly easy to replicate site to site. But actually, shared storage, SAN storage and network storage, often is not replicated, because it's actually quite difficult to do real-time replication from a primary data center to a secondary one. But that's normally achieved quite happily with the database. So where that needs to be done and where that type of infrastructure isn't available, RightFax now has an option to move the images into SQL. Now, this also means that rather than coping with file security and folder structure security, people that have tried implementing EFS, I have to say, find that quite complicated with RightFax servers for no specific reason. What we can do with this is we can move the images from the shared storage and place them in the database. This means that replication that's done from primary to secondary or even tertiary data centers for the database will then apply to the fax images. And that can be combined with encryption. So those images can be in the database and encrypted and replicated, and of course all the SQL security that you have. One thing that we're aware of is when audit people as well look at a RightFax server, it can be quite complicated because it seems to step across a lot of industry and technology boundaries. So actually having everything stored within the database has often simplified that process. So that's an optional module as well. This module, and we talked about the image encryption, those are both solution-wide. So that would cover as many shared service nodes as you have, or as many servers as you have within your collective. So this is how that architecture would then look. We have now three components: application, queues, and database. So hopefully that explains what options we're suggesting you look at from a securing the RightFax point of view. So let's quickly look at a summary of those. So firstly, use the core features in RightFax. RightFax will leverage the stuff you've already done in your network, the ways that you already make your application secure. RightFax can use those. Encrypt the storage. That's images at rest. Encrypt transport, SIP over TLS. And maybe use the secure messaging, especially if you've already got that. Most enterprise scale sites already have that licensing on RightFax. So please do look at that. Get rid of fax machines. This seems like a message that we were doing 20 years ago, but it's still a relevant message today. Particularly in the public sector, fax machines still exist. And the only driver for that is because they're operating with a piece of paper. Replace that with multifunction device capabilities. And finally, use the infrastructure that's already been built. RightFax can leverage that. A couple of other quick things. RunFlag's current version is 16EP, version 16EP4. If you are running 10.6 or earlier, they are now end of life, or what we call sustaining maintenance. And that's been the case since the 1st of November. If you want to talk to us about those upgrade options, do talk to your account manager or come directly to our sales team, and we'll help you discuss that. Okay, I think that's it. If there's no more questions, thank you for attending today. I hope that was useful. I apologize if we've rather rushed through it, but there's a lot to talk about with this, and we're really keen that actually you secure your fax server. RunFlag has been used for a long time because of its security benefits, and each new version just seems to bring new, useful, and exciting features. So from a security point of view, it really is a useful conversation. Thank you very much.